Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY. My name is Lauren DiGiulio, and I'm the Associate Director of Programs here at the Siegel Center. The person who normally stands in this position, our Executive Director, Frank Henschker, is unable to be with us this evening as he had to directly fly to Germany on Saturday. So he does send his regrets and wishes he could be with us for the evening. So in lieu of his presence, I'd like to just say thank you and thank you for coming and joining us. This marks the first program of our spring 2013 season, and our center bridges the gap between the academic and professional performing arts communities, so we bring artists and academics in conversation with each other. And tonight we are very honored to have with us members of the production team of the Women Project Theater production of Jackie, which is playing at the City Center through March 31st. And I've been asked also to remind all of you that we have some discount codes available at our merchandise table outside, so if you haven't already picked those up, you can receive $25 tickets for productions that are running through this weekend. So Jackie is written by an Austrian playwright, Alfreda Jelinek, who won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 2004. And tonight we're going to focus our discussion on the challenges of bringing Jelinek's work, which is highly complex and deeply layered, to the stage. So tonight I'd like to thank the members of the Women's Project team for being with us, as well as theater critic and professor at Hunter College, CUNY, Jonathan Powell, who has twice received the George Nathan Award for Dramatic Criticism and who will be moderating our discussion this evening. I also wanted to say thank you so much to you artists who've taken the time out of your busy lives and your busy production schedule to come and share your insight with us this evening. I'd like to ask everyone to just please remember to turn off your cell phones. And I will do it right now as well, so we can all enjoy our discussion in silence with video clips and discussion. So thank you so much, and at this point I'll turn over to Jonathan Kalb. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Welcome to everyone. I'm extremely honored to have been asked to moderate this panel. It seems to me that something very important is happening in connection with this panel, which is the production of Alfreda Jelinek's Jackie in New York. I was told that this is the first, that the agent of Alfreda Jelinek has said that this is the first American production of a play by Alfreda Jelinek. I'll get to that in a moment, but first I want to introduce our panelists. To my left is the director of this production, Taya Alagic. She is an alumna of the Women's Project Lab, and she has directed Saviana Stanescu's Aliens with Extraordinary Skills at the Women's Project. And I first saw her work when she directed The Brothers' Sighs at the Public Theater, which I thought was an extraordinary production. I'm not going to go through her whole bio because you can read it, but Taya is a Bosnian and a Croatian, an expatriate who I think, was secreted out of the country to protect her as a child, made her way to the United States, and found her way into the Yale School of Drama directing program, and was launched from there. And we're very happy to have her. And if you haven't seen this production, you really must go and see what Taya has done with this text. To my right is the translator of the play, Geeta Honegger, who is a professor of theater at Arizona State University. Can I tell the crowd that you're also a former teacher of mine? Geeta was a professorin She spent 10 years at Yale. While I was there, she was the resident dramaturg. She directed. I didn't know this until Jackie, but she was an early member of the Women's Project. Geeta has translated all kinds of material. She did a biography, an excellent biography of Thomas Bernhard. She's Austrian, also an expatriate. Came here when she was very young, and she'll probably have a chance to explain why. This was not running from a war, not her parents sending her abroad, but her sending herself abroad, possibly to get away from some of the same things that Elfriede Jelinek writes about in her books. But Geeta has become the chosen translator, the author's chosen translator of these unique plays. And that is a mixed blessing, shall we say, because it's extremely difficult work, and Geeta has done a remarkable job. Once again, you really must see Jackie in order to understand what I'm talking about. On this side is the extraordinary dramaturg and set designer of this production, Marcia Ginsburg, has designed this incredible dilapidated swimming pool set for the production, which I'm not going to do justice to in words. You just have to see it. It's an incredible thing. She's designed for the Women's Project before. She did Sheila Callahan's Lascivious Something, and just a long list of other wonderful productions that you can read about on her bio. To her left is Megan Carter, the dramaturg and the associate artistic director of the Women's Project. And she has worked with Taya before. She's worked with Ann Bogart, with Lynn Rosen, Daniela Topol, and others. And I understand from both Taya and Geeta that Megan has been crucial to the preparation of this text, to figuring out what sort of English equivalents we can find to the inventions of the author and so on. So let me just tell you a little bit about Elfriede Jelinek. This is an author who I think to call her controversial would be an understatement. She was born in 1946, and she is sometimes put in a triumvirate of Austrian writers, including mm-hmm. Peter Handke and Thomas Bernhard. Austrian writers who are, shall we say, difficult. But it goes beyond difficult, particularly with Jelinek and Bernhard. They belong to a category of writer that the in German is known as the Nestbeschmutzer, someone who soils his own nest, who's constantly, or her own nest, constantly lobbing critical grenades at the society in order to accomplish what? This is the question. This is one of the questions I hope we'll take up today, which is, what is she about as an author? But she is, she's not merely a provocateur, but she is a provocateur. She's deliberately a provocateur in many ways. In terms of what she has to say about sexuality, about stereotypical roles of men and women, about the history of her own country, she exists in this unique Austrian circumstance, in which everything is a silent scandal. Every new appearance of her work is a silent scandal. And this circumstance of Totschweigen, which Geeta has described, is a good way of putting it, where she'll publish a work or a new play of hers will be produced, and in Vienna, a scandal is different from a scandal anywhere else in the world, because what it means is that nobody says anything. The work appears, and nobody says anything. Thomas Bernhard once wrote a book about his awards and how he couldn't He got all these awards in his lifetime, but he couldn't take most of them with respect, because he didn't have, he knew that they were all compensations for people's bad consciences.
He loved it, though.
Of course. But
he's Austrian, too.
It's his way of breaking the silence. And it's a little bit complicated to be an Austrian author who is always provoking your own culture, because that particular kind of scandal doesn't export. The plays don't play the same way in Berlin or Paris or London or New York as they're going to play in Vienna. And so it's not necessarily a scandal. It's something else. And this is another thing we're going to talk about today. For many years, when Elfriede Jelinek was young, she wrote plays with dialogue. She wrote a play which was turned into a Comden and Green musical. It was called What Happened After Nora Left Her Husband. It was a sequel to A Doll's House. And in this play, Nora takes up with a businessman who uses her to get, to spy on her husband's business dealings, and gets what he wants business-wise out of the connection, and then drops her in the gutter. And it was made into a musical by Comden and Green, directed on Broadway by Hal Prince. It was called A Doll's Life. And it played in 1982 for 18 performances. It closed 5 days after its premiere. Not many people saw it. I saw it. This is why I questioned before whether this is actually the American premiere of Jelinek. No one seems to remember this but me. So we can, maybe because it's a musical. For many, many years now, Jelinek has written all of her theatrical works as massive blocks of text. They sometimes have stage directions, but they're not the kind of helpful stage directions that directors work from as blueprints for stage action. He enters here, and she enters there, and so on. She calls them plays, but she is completely indifferent to matters of production. She cedes responsibility for production completely to the directors. And so every single production is an adaptation, you might say. In the premiere, it's already an adaptation because the director has to invent the theatrical presence of the work in a way that another kind of director does not have to. The works are logorrheic monologues. They are studies in excess. They loop back on themselves multiple times. They are dense with literary references, pop culture references, media references. They have puns that are highbrow and lowbrow that drive Gita mad. The voices are multiple. You can't really say that the speaking figures are characters in the usual sense of a specific, psychologically integral character. They are really composite voices. They're sites of projected fantasy and myth. They're vessels for social polemic. So I hope you can understand from just what I've said why it might have taken so long for this author's work to come to the United States. Because it's not just a question of our taste, it's that directors like Taya don't grow here all that often. And so you need someone to finish the theatrical invention. And I think this is a remarkable job. Another thing that makes this a wonderful debut for Jelinek in America is that the subject matter is Jackie O. This is an American icon. This is someone who's was the wife, a widow of a president, the widow of a billionaire. Her life was played out as a mythical fairy tale for us. And so what a great subject. That's as much as I want to say introducing Jelinek. What we're going to do now is begin with a video clip of the author herself, just a couple of minutes, so you get to see who she is, how she presents herself. This is a clip of Elfriede Jelinek accepting the Nobel Prize. She won the Nobel Prize in 2004. Very controversial winner. One of the members of the Nobel Committee resigned in protest after she got the award. So when I say that she's a provocateur, she truly is. She has a brand of social phobia that is like agoraphobia, and I will let Gita speak more about this later. So she did not go to Stockholm to accept the Nobel Prize. What you're going to see is the video she had of herself making a speech that was sent to Stockholm for the ceremony. Okay?
Abseits. Ist Schreiben die Gabe der Schmiegsamkeit, der Anschmiegsamkeit an die Wirklichkeit? Man möchte sich ja gern anschmiegen, aber was geschieht da mit mir? Was geschieht mit denen, die die Wirklichkeit gar nicht wirklich kennen? Die ist ja sowas von zerzaust. Kein Kamm, der sie glätten könnte. Die Dichter fahren hindurch und versammeln ihre Haare verzweifelt zu einer Frisur, von der sie dann in den Nächten prompt heimgesucht werden. Etwas stimmt nicht mehr mit dem Aussehen. Aus seinem Heim der Träume kann das schön aufgetürmte Haar wieder verjagt werden, das sich aber ohne dies nicht mehr zähmen lässt. Oder wieder zusammengefallen ist und nun als Schleier vor einem Gesicht hängt, kaum dass es endlich gebändigt werden konnte. Oder unwillkürlich zu Berge steht vor Entsetzen vor dem, was dauernd geschieht. Es lässt sich einfach nicht ordnen. Es will nicht. So oft man auch mit dem Kamm, mit ein paar ausgebrochenen Zinken hindurchfährt, es will einfach nicht. Etwas stimmt jetzt noch weniger. Das Geschriebene, das vom Geschehen handelt, läuft einem unter der Hand davon wie die Zeit und nicht nur die Zeit, während der es geschrieben wurde, während der nicht gelebt wurde. Niemand hat etwas versäumt, wenn nicht gelebt worden ist. Nicht der Lebende und nicht die getötete Zeit und der Tote schon gar nicht.
Okay, so I thought I would just begin by asking Gita if you would speak about Jelinek and what you think her presence is as an author. What, how would you describe her writing generally?
Can I backtrack a little
sure.
bit just to respond? You said that her plays don't really export well, not even to Germany. But the fact
the scandals don't export. The plays can go,
yeah.
but the plays
okay,
are something
yes,
else.
Because they actually her career was made in Germany
yeah.
without German directors, because in Austria they hated her too much. What is her presence? Well, first of all, she's a woman of her generation, which is at this transitional time, which I think hasn't ended, where women first could write, be acknowledged, and were outspoken about it. Now, when you have in the Austrian tradition, you have one woman writer before her, particularly Ingeborg Bachmann. And she was still, well, she suffered from that too, very tried to sort of fit into the male world, you know, being nice. And in German, it's das Weibchen, like the little pussycat, which Jelinek definitely is not. So she comes out very provocative from day one, undermines patriarchic language, which was where we were heading off then, uses the canon, understands the canon really, really well, but then fragments it so that we can show what happened to what is the language after, can we have poetry after the Holocaust? Jelinek says, because of the Holocaust, we must write. Okay. And she explained to me also that in Germany after the war, because of the American occupation, Germans were exposed much more to the best in journalism, which may not be the case now, but at that time it was our model, really open, open investigative journalism. In Austria, we got rid of the occupation sooner, and therefore the artists took over. to critique the culture. And her model was what was called the Vienna School, and that was when we first, after the Holocaust and the war, Austria became familiar with the Surrealists, with Dada, and with all the movements which we were cut out. And as well, it was actually the Vienna School who started to dismantle language and frame language and ask those questions, do we have the right to still speak this language? Now, this offends a lot of the still very powerful male dominance in the culture. If you look at pictures and representation of industrialists, of politicians, Angela Merkel, of course, is now it's getting somewhat better, but it is still very male representation. And women, if Bernhard could rattle off the biggest insults, and ultimately he was accepted as the authority. When a woman speaks up, and she very strongly believes in that, and it's true, if she's questioned and she's hated. And you look very suspicious, because I know I sound now like a rabid feminist, but it is true in that society. And so then like in all other societies, people who hate people the most, a place, they haven't seen the place, they don't read it. Jelinek wrote this novel, Lust, and so the bookstores were first selling out because the men came and thought it's pornography. So it was bought. Then they found out it isn't. It is deconstructing pornography in very pornographic terms. So then they hated her. But of course, since Austria is such a small country and they're so proud of culture and their accomplishments, and it has the Alps and the Echo, everything you do there is then multiplied 10 times over. And that's how Bernhard made it, and then she was she was the female, especially when Bernhard died, she was then his successor as the queen of the Nestbeschmutzer.
I should mention that this is, Jelinek is a novelist and a playwright, in 2007 there was a review of a novel, Greed, by Tim Parks in the New York Review of Books, which resulted in a stern letter from Gita in response, because in the whole article, Tim Parks failed to mention ever that Jelinek had written plays. I wonder, is this, Parks responded and he was, it's all very, very polite, but is her presence more as a novelist than as a dramatist?
Well, it was Bernhard too. But the interesting thing now, she is one of the most performed playwrights in Germany. And since the Nobel Prize, she only wrote one novel. And then only plays. She immediately respond to political or social conditions. And then she goes off and writes her interventions.
Okay.
She doesn't refer to her plays as plays, by the way. She calls texts for speaking and texts for reading.
Oh, okay.
So she stays with text.
Jackie belongs to a group of Jelinek plays called Princess plays,
yeah.
Princess and drama,
yeah.
And they are about figures like Snow White, Sleeping Beauty, legendary and historical figures who are defined by and trapped by their legends, you might say. And so, in a way, they're trying to speak themselves out of this entrapment. So, can I just turn to Thea and say, how did you get hold of this work?
I first read it in 2004 when I was at Yale, because there was first translation came out. First time I actually heard of Jelinek was kind of obvious through movie Piano Teacher. But then the plays I read in 2004.
The Michael Haneke made a film of her novel, The Piano Teacher, in 2001. A lot of people might be their most, what she's most familiar with.
Yeah. And the work that came to United States, basically.
So you read it, and then what? Why, did you read all the princess plays?
Yes, and then I read Bambi Land, and then I went crazy about it. And I asked my classmates to read it with me to see how it sounds.
Bambi Land is a play from 2003, I believe, that deals with the Iraq War.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that?
Oh. It's, again, a very intense play, and we had a cold reading of, at Yale, and was not with actors. It was just with people who are actually not. And it was very powerful, and we have questions after the reading. How can you stage something like this? Because there were again no stage directions, no explanation, nothing. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. One of Yelinek's habits is to put, instead of stage direction, sometimes recommended reading. So you'll be reading along, and where someone else might say, enter Jackie or exit through the gift shop. It gives a list of books. So what does that mean, Megan? I'll turn to you as a dramaturg. How are we to think about that in terms of a theatrical guideline?
Well, I think in the case of Jackie, she actually, in the script, says that her collaborators are several authors from which some of the information in the play came from. So Brandi Terabarelli is an American author that wrote two books about Jackie Kennedy and a book about Marilyn Monroe. And they're trashy, trashy, dishy,
they're fun to read.
Books. They're so much fun to read. but you can actually see where she quotes or misquotes these books in the text. So you have to read them. Like you can't avoid what she references.
Well, we're in the United States of America. We can avoid any reading we like. What do you mean we have to read them?
Well, I think one of the things that was important, for this production was for us to actually understand Jackie Kennedy. You can't, by the way. And I think one of the things that we learned, which would have been, I think, not good for the production had we not learned it, had we not followed Yelinek's lead and read the books, is that everything about Jackie Kennedy is a contradiction. So, and you could read the books from one page to the next. Things would work against each other. One person would say one thing to define Jackie, and then another person would immediately say something else. The author even would draw a conclusion about Jackie, and then in the next breath, next paragraph, contradict himself.
So, I'm interested in the fact that you decided at some point to enter this text by researching the historical Jackie. Was that necessarily the way you had to go?
Absolutely. Absolutely. We had a long preparation period, and we read everything we could find. And it was extremely helpful to find out whatever the truth is here about Jackie, but to know the more possibly you can. Yeah. And then also the way Yelinek wrote the play, it kind of referenced a lot of what we read, so most of it was important.
Yeah, it also, there's a line in the play, well, she references photographs, both in the one set of very odd stage directions that she has and also in the text. So, I mean, we found it very helpful for the production to actually look at the photographs, not only that Yelinek referenced, but more and more photographs of Jackie in terms of visual ideas for the play.
Yeah. Well, Tina Benko was quoted in the paper yesterday as saying that we need to distinguish the character she's playing from the historical Jackie. So where are we with this research-based approach?
Well, there's more research than just reading about Jackie. I mean, one of the things that we discovered is when you research Jackie Kennedy, you go into a rabbit hole,
yeah.
And you can't find the truth, and you, it illustrates the slippery nature of the truth and the slippery nature of image, which then helps you understand what Jelinek is actually grappling with, which is not Jackie Kennedy. But we also, the research went beyond what sort of Jelinek's stage directions sent us toward. We also, I mean, at one point I was researching Persephone, the Persephone myths and the underworld, and at the same time looking at German cabaret, and at the same time looking at American vaudeville, and there's sort of a mashup of trying to figure out how this Austrian writer writing about this American icon in order to explore something that has nothing to do with this actual person can speak to an American audience.
And also how to create a character for Tina. Because we were researching Jackie's voice, and there's just recordings, a book came out just recently, mm-hmm. 2008, I think, about Jackie history recordings.
The interviews with Schlesinger.
Yeah, and the whole idea of Jackie's voice, it's not really exactly the voice she presented.
She made up a voice.
She made up a voice, and then you're
television.
Thinking, what did she made up her whole image and who she really was? And that was interesting for Tina, too, to find a balance between the idea of Jackie and how we're going to present the character.
Tina figuring out how to create a character based on a character who was creating a character.
Yep.
Was Tina privy to all of this background reading, or did she?
She as she's told me yesterday, she's listening tapes every day before she go on stage.
Of what?
Of Jackie. It was eight hours of Jackie.
Wow. Huh. And how did you begin to conceive the production physically? How did you begin to discuss things with Marcia?
Yeah, how we do it.
How do we do it? Should I?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I mean, I think that the thing that's hard is again, like following, you know, through with the text, that unlike most, I shouldn't say most American plays, but often there's a sense of a location that is offered to you in a play text. This piece offers nothing to you. So it's just a, you know, as you articulately stated, it's just a, you know, kind of almost like a wall of language. So for us, you know, we're trying to figure out what is the context to place this in and how to sort of, I mean, I almost feel like for me, it's almost like creating a landscape for the piece to live inside of. And also the other thing that's really key about it is that because so much of what will happen in the mise-en-scène of Thea will happen in the rehearsal process. So you begin with this essential problem of theater that the set design is always conceived months before the rehearsal process begins. So we're kind of starting from this place of wanting to create a landscape that is both specific in terms of the dramaturgy of what we're exploring with the piece content-wise, but it's not so specific physically that it begins to create, you know, maybe negative obstacles that it doesn't allow a kind of open process to happen in rehearsal. So it's kind of beginning in that place of being specific and yet not specific at the same time. And I guess we just explored so many different ideas for it. I mean, it was a long process, like happening over many months. And I think the thing that we both really landed on together is this concept that Jackie's in the underworld. And so then it's like an endless brainstorming of like, what is the underworld?
Where is the underworld?
We have a few pictures of Marcia's work. Could we show the still photos of the set, please? This is the edge of of what looks like an empty swimming pool. It's much wider than this, and it curves way around. That's not even the full expanse of it. It goes, you know, another probably 12 feet to either side. There, you can see the curve of it there. What's that? This is Tina Banco, yes. And these are her dead baggage that the character carries around. They're marked, Jack, Bobby, and Ari, right? Yeah.
And then the babies.
Plus the little babies that were her miscarriages.
And, yeah.
Okay. Right. So that gives you a little sense. So I understand that it's associative and that the swimming pool is not specifically mentioned in the text and that you wanted an underworld. Why a swimming pool? I know this is tough questions for designers, but I would love to hear what you have to say about that.
Well, it's interesting because I think that I read this. One of the things that was really helpful to me in reading were actually these essays by this writer Wayne Kostenbaum, and he wrote this article about Jackie and water, which I really loved. And, you know, one of the things that he's constantly referring to is that whenever there's like a crisis in the Kennedy family, they always go to, you know, their estate in Martha's Vineyard. So there's always like, there are always these very meditative images that we have of like Jackie strolling on the beach or other Kennedys strolling on the beach. So that idea of, you know, this kind of idea of water just really caught my attention, and I don't know how we got to the swimming pool. I mean, I think it's like maybe like you could think of a swimming pool as being like a social construction of like mimicking something, you know, natural like the sea, and but also what was tough is that we didn't want it. There was a whole discussion of like wanting a swimming pool, but not wanting the coding of it to be so extremely indicative of a swimming pool. And so we were kind of sharing images of these abandoned swimming pools, but also of these kind of industrial places, plants. And like there was this one image that Taya had sent me that actually had a curved wall of a kind of curved wall of tile that was like really, really mucky. And it looked like a swimming pool in the way that some swimming pools have that kind of curved plane, but it actually was like a, you know, abandoned industrial building. And so in a certain way, we were kind of trying to have it both ways, which is not always so easy to have. And, you know, like the latter became this huge
question
because, you know, the space is sort of vague in the sense that, you know, the white tile can also refer to morgues or subways, and the concrete curve could, you know, have an industrial reference. But as soon as you put a swimming pool ladder, then you know that you're actually in a swimming pool. And so it was really important that we did not have that. And so this ladder is actually, and it's an industrial, it's like what they use in factories. It's kind of like an OSHA standard industrial ladder. So we're kind of trying to have it both ways. And it's interesting because I'm not sure if we have it both ways or whether it's just like reads so intensely as a swimming pool.
Well, one of the things I liked about it is that swimming pools are all evoking memories of people in bathing suits. So they're they're about physical beauty, whether you like it or not, because that's where your memory goes. And if it's dilapidated, it, you know, it becomes about the passage of time and the passing of physical beauty. All of that is echoing in the production. So I don't know. That's what I got out of it.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing too to say is that I really kind of am interested in this idea of like creating, like really working with the architecture of the space, and the architecture of the space, it's a basement basically. So I kept imagining like as though I was creating this like basement swimming pool in the city center space, so people could in fact imagine that maybe this would have been here in this space at some point
at
in
some
time.
Point.
Those dummies that you saw are actually in the text. There's a stage direction at the beginning of this text. Do you have it? Does anybody have it?
I have it.
Can you read the opening stage direction?
Sure. Jackie should appear in a Chanel suit, I think. You would have to have very good reasons to do it differently. One could also take as a model that last photograph in Central Park with Maurice Templesman, the one on the bench, trench coat, wig, hair lost because of chemo, sunglasses, Hermes scarf. In any case, she should work hard. I imagine all her dead loved ones, her children, well, the embryo and the two dead babies aren't that heavy, but those dead men, Jack, Bobby, Ari, they'll be quite a load. So, how shall I put it? She should drag those dead ones behind her, like in a tug of war, or like a Volga boatman with his boat. Sorry, I can't make it easier for you. At least the blood on her suit doesn't weigh that much, and there is a chunk missing from Jack's skull. The actress should drag the bodies, which are tied to each other, behind her with great effort, which makes her speech increasingly breathless. Panting for breath, she will have to stop her monologue at some point because she can't go on. According to her condition and the way she feels on a given day, this will happen sometimes sooner, sometimes later, and then the monologue is done and over. But I'm sure you'll come up with something completely different. That is the only stage direction.
Taya, could you talk about your thoughts regarding that stage direction? Even just why you decided to follow it?
You know, I'm one of these directors who believe everything that is written on page, I have to respect it. So it's a very interesting conversation about stage directions, because I think that she informed me about how monologue should go and about how rhythmically actors should speak. So even if you don't use these bodies and you don't use the stage direction that in the end she says you can, you know, of course come up with something different, it informs you how to go about a text and actor in space. We did a lot of work with that, and we arrived to what Tina is doing today with playing with it. I totally respect it, but of course I didn't do it. You know, she's not carrying these bodies the whole time. It's just a little bit in the beginning and a little bit in the end.
Yeah. No, but it's the big opening and closing prop.
Uh-huh. Yes, and I also do think that it forms audience clearly what they're going to see, because it's really funny.
And they're very strange looking.
And strangely looking, so it gives you an idea of what kind of play, what kind of show we're going to see. Yeah.
There are a number of Barbie dolls in the production, too. I lost count. And they do terrible things to the filtration system of this swimming pool. Are they in the text? They're not in the text.
No.
Right, so you added the Barbie dolls.
We added the Barbie.
Could you talk about the Barbie dolls?
For me, it first came when I was talking with Susan Hillfury. She was like, "Did you see that? You had a chance to see how many Barbies exist that they look like Jackie and they look like Marilyn Monroe?"
I might not have paid attention.
Yeah,
enough.
Me either. But then Susan was like, and I'm like, "Wow!" And then me and you talked about it. And
right, we started going down this road of like looking at Barbie's dream house, and it was like a early set design idea. Yeah. Whether because there's those cardboard. From the 70s, these kind of like cardboard boxes that have the paintings of the Barbie interiors. And so there was a moment that we were like, oh, maybe we should do a set like Barbie's Dream House or something. So I guess it was just like it was just always a lingering thread in the conversation. And so, you know, again, I think that what Teo was interested in doing in rehearsal was to kind of like keep, like, maybe I'm wrong in this, but like it seemed like that these threads that we were talking about all through the development process kind of ended up, fragments of them in the rehearsal process, like, you know, a Barbie doll, and just to see whether it made sense or not to work with it.
But then Gita mentioned...
This is so phenomenal. Sorry. When some of the choices you make, there's such an insight into Elfriede herself, because when I visited her after she had the Nobel Prize, she showed me what I played with too, and she obviously too. There's a forerunner of the Barbie doll, and that's the Austrian Lily doll. And actually, she is almost the same looking. And she said to me, you know, my aunt gave that to me. My aunt was a fashion designer. And actually, if I wouldn't have become a writer, I would have become a fashion designer. And you have another moment where you just, what I told you today, except the scene is cut. There's a wonderful scene when she sits at the edge of the pool and serves like little dolls a tea set. And that's what Elfriede does when you visit her, that she's very motherly and she then very well behaved, because people think it's this aggressive dominatrix or something. And she's very, this well-bred Viennese lady. And then she takes you in and she makes sure you have coffee. And we actually had the cups, these nice Vienna, you know, they're Czech, those, you know, the onion thing. And it's just the insights artists have and cross over, and it's not necessarily a research. Mm. It is research, but it comes from another direction. And also that, I wanted to say, it's a little bit misleading, I think, for people who haven't seen it, that it's not at all about Jackie, because then why call something Jackie? Yeah. It is actually a dialogue with Jackie. It is a woman growing up, we all growing up at the time, and we were in a very impressionable age when, of course, Camelot happened. And she talks about that, too. And so since she is almost our generation, I think she's exploring that public perception, also her own perception, because we were, as she mentioned in the interview with the Times when then the article came out, that she was very young, and that's in the glow of her youth. And it was very shaping for our identity, actually, the two, Jack and Jackie. So it is very intensely about her, but I think in the same way you then connect to Elfriede. Hmm. She has that connection and then tries to figure out from this image, how does that relate? Hmm. So it is very much about it, and you very much found that deep connection there.
You know, we have a two-minute clip of Tina playing Jackie. Why don't we give the audience a chance to see a few minutes of this performance? Can you roll that, please?
I politely take off myself when I'm talking to someone, and yet I also stay, though far above. I prefer to be suspended in all those pictures of myself and dragged along. That way I don't have to do anything. On the other hand, there are those furious activities in matters of home furnishing and decorating. Early American. Crowned like a rotting tooth with Louis XVI drapes. That's what they used to call good taste in those days. Imagine. No. Better not imagine things. Because one never knows which pot feeds the imagination in the soup kitchen of the poor. I had to come and suggest myself to the population, which put its faith in me and got nothing in return. One must add pomp and majesty to everything except oneself. You should stay simple. And that takes guts, especially for the sort of total restraint, the barely breathed trifles, a boldness that turns into complete stillness as soon as you appear to the public as Our Lady of Miracles. It's a miracle that a picture like me can speak at all.
So I'd like to if we could get into the very knotty question of what this play has to say. It's not as though we're going to be able to say, well, Jackie's a Barbie, or anything simple like that. What about Jackie? What is Elfriede Jelinek saying about Jackie? Why write a play about Jackie?
I just told you that it was something it fit into her princess plays. Because she also wrote about Princess Di. So she goes with an American icon and with maybe, one of, for Europeans, of course, the presidency, which they could most relate to because of their interest in culture. And then, of course, of the tragedy, because it affected, it's not an American phenomenon alone. I mean, America belongs to the world or has that impact. So she would, why write a movie about Gandhi?
Well, this is not a biopic. This is a meditation on a number of issues. There's a dark light opposition in it where she calls herself the dark woman and Marilyn is the light woman. This goes on and on and on, this distinction that she's obsessively, compulsively making between herself and this other woman who was also attractive to her husband. There's lots and lots of talk about the miscarriages that she suffered and how the miscarriages may actually have been caused by venereal disease that she contracted from her philandering husband. There's a whole thematic pursuit of whether she was ever properly born, which I was saying to Gita had reminded me of Beckett's play Not I, as though this person is not just post-death but pre-birth. Why Jackie? Why pursue all of these things through this historical figure who has so many, as you say, knowable biographical facts attached to her? How does that help?
Well, you say who has all of these knowable biographical facts attached to her, but she's also someone who guarded herself very, very, very closely, which I think makes her interesting for study. I mean, there's so many things that the play can be about, and people respond to different things, but one of the things that strikes me is that there is no privacy, that everybody is projecting a persona into the world. It's something that we're all doing now, and it was just beginning with the Kennedys, the advent of television, the ability to actually put something forward that was maybe not you, to put forward the mask to a wide audience. That Jackie was, the reason Jackie, as opposed to somebody else necessarily, is that Jackie was constructing something. She was constructing a persona and she was guarding her private self. So there's something, but people felt like they knew her, that they owned her, that she was part of them. People have a huge emotional attachment. Like you read about, Wayne Kostenbaum actually talks about not attending the funeral, but being outside of Jackie's funeral and, you know, people weeping, but then also like very, in a very tawdry way, like grabbing for things that could be mementos of the funeral. So you have this person, this icon in America that everybody thinks they have a piece of, who was fighting, Jackie was fighting very hard to keep all of her pieces to herself. And that to me feels like what Jelinek is really grappling with. So in some ways, Jackie is the perfect person to explore that through.
I think you have to still look at that in a larger context. You ask now very American questions. I mean, what is the meaning? What do you think she wanted to say? We don't know what she wanted to say.
I have to plead guilty to be American.
No, but for
ever your since Yale, I was born.
For your Yale education with Richard Gilman, you should have a more world from other learning to from other perspectives and maybe a little bit of a postmodern perspective. But on the other hand, if you look at the big picture, there you have the Kennedys in the early 60s. There you have a writer, very impressionable. And she is looking, I mean, she looks at, you mentioned them all. There is the sexy light woman, and then there's the other one who is another kind of female type, archetype, which we get associated with. As we talked before, you have Karl Kraus, and not only him, the juxtaposition, the saint and the prostitute. And it's very much the 60s. And you can't get around this. And the world changed in the 60s when the Kennedys came along, because that was, for a war-torn and destroyed and horrible world and Europe, that was a rebirth. Suddenly there was something we could identify, and suddenly there was hope there's a better world. This is why I ended up here. I'm totally out of my free will. And that's why she then fought that. But you cannot underestimate on our generation that impact and the importance to the world. America is important to the world in ways that it can't put itself, though, into the position of the other. And that's what you should try and do, too. Well, I mean, great, you're an American. I'm too, by the way. But you don't have to, you know, raise the flag. So I'm Yale. Sorry, he was my student. And he was a terrific, brilliant student.
Well, where to go from here?
So can't we look at a play in the postmodern world that it's a dialogue between the author and the person? It's a much more humble approach, because it's not saying, I know all about Jackie. It is, there's something I get from Jackie. The marriage, the venereal disease. I mean, these are all things women grapple with all the time, and it's a universal problem, or universal questions. So I think that's the novel approach. Not so much in other countries, but here we look so much that the play then has an individual, and that author has then given that individual, has some magic insight into the psychology and everything. It's a lie, and she's exposing that lie, including herself, as perceiving a public image.
I certainly don't mean to ask the question in a way that's simplistic by saying that we need to discover the one thing that Elfriede Jelinek has to say about Jackie. But there are certain questions that she's posing in a particular way for us that it would help to try and articulate. And there's a sense in which the production has formulated them in a particular way by characterizing Tina Benko in this way and by putting the set together in this way. I think it's fair to ask what it is that is asking us to think about.
Okay, but I may remind you that she also is called the forerunner of post-dramatic theater. That is where we also don't have the authority to speak for everybody. And that's particularly Jelinek. That's why her stage directions are not just cute. Hmm. And there is a reason for that. She is very much going against the authorial position, saying, this is what I do, and I share it with you, but you do what you want to do. If you can't use it, forget it, don't do it. But if you do it, accept it, and then bring yourself as the co-author into it. So actually, it is a dialogue between all the artists present here. And that's where her innovation is. And that's very hard to take, because we are looking always for meaning.
Is there a feminist issue in that?
In what?
In the breakdown of central authority.
Is there a feminist when a woman writes a play? Yes.
In the breakdown of central authority in the author
position? Of course, of course. And where I found a connection to her, now that's a little more theoretical, that's the post-colonial theorists, because they dealt with hegemonial language, with colonialist language. Now, if you grow up in Austria, you're hit over the head with Goethe and Schiller and the Greeks, because the Germans thought that they inherited the Greeks. So you had this amazing culture with capital K. So obviously, you're going to then say, hey, wait a minute, there are other voices.
Culture is
and they are not
K.
all the Holy Marys who just are there at the manger and pray with little sheep around it. They are very important figures, even in Austrian history. But they were over suppressed. Now, I'm a little modest because you can't just take over the post-colonial discourse, but since that discourse is very closely connected to feminist discourse, we can learn about how women have to deal with the male canon. And this is not just the old, you know, the 60s rebellious feminists. I think that's an issue we are still dealing with very much. Because Jelinek's audiences around the world, other than here, are young people. Young women and young men, too, they connect to her.
I'd like to read a statement by the man who resigned in protest from the Nobel Prize Committee after Elfriede Jelinek was awarded the prize. He says that her themes are denigration, humiliation, desecration, and self-disgust, sadism, and masochism, all in a massive text shoveled together without artistic structure.
Wow.
In a kind of a takedown article in the New Republic, just after the award, Ruth Franklin, very smart woman who's become one of the associate editors of the magazine, echoed these feelings and included some long quotes from a couple of novels and plays that seemed to her disgusting and pornographic. And so my question is there a possibly a feminist issue involved in the rejection of this author, in the reflexive response to her and the slowness to accept her.
I think it's a little too simplistic to just call it a feminist issue because
well, women, I'm asking.
Some women are as offended by her as men are because her criticism is not involves women as well. Her criticism is society. It is not necessarily just the individual, but how the individual responds to society's demands. So the women who buy into, you know, the Weibchen, the little pussycat, that she does, she is very harsh against. Now, you have to also remember that she started out as a Marxist and actually joined the Communist Party, and as she told me, as a woman, she could only end as a post-World War II member of the generation. That was the only way she could say, I resist what my world was, what your world was and what you created. So if you think about it from a Marxist point of view, and I'm not necessarily communist, you will think about society as a whole or not just male and female. And that makes her very complicated. And I think in our world also, we are so used to exaggerated images that to see where she is framing that in order to subvert it is very hard.
Do you really think that a male author who became known with these same kinds of quote-unquote disgusting imagery and themes would be dismissed in quite this kind of shaming way? Is there not a tone in the rejection of Jelinek that is, in fact, directed at her femaleness?
No. She would say that. I would say it's directed against her language because we get most offended when the language doesn't fit smoothly and we can communicate. And she doesn't do that. She says, not. This is the language. I'm cutting it up. And I will show you if you grow, anybody, if we would translate everything where we get impressions from, and then we pick a few and put them together. I think that is what she's showing us.
We have four women up here. I wonder if we could get some other opinions. We have the Associate Artistic Director of the Women's Project. Could Megan, could you talk about this, about what decision to choose this text, what you might think of any of these thoughts?
When I got interested in Jelinek several years ago, I think around the time she got the Nobel Prize, and I tracked down Bambi Land and loved it and didn't have a director in mind, and so just abandoned it because it's not the kind of text that you go, oh, we're going to do this. Let's find some people to make this happen. So when Taya brought Jackie, it was really exciting because you have a director going, I'm going to do something with this. And when I read it, Women's Project is by nature of what it is, obviously a feminist organization, but we're very interested in what women have to say about everything. The term women's issues is not a word, not a phrase that we really want floating around in our office because we think all issues are women's issues. So I wasn't necessarily thinking about the feminist bent of Jelinek when I read the play. I just read the play and went, oh my God, how do you do this? I want to do this. How do you do this? And the density of the text and trying to figure out like how the, you know, she'll start a word game on page 2 that doesn't end until page 7, and then she'll pick it up again 3 pages later. Like, how do you stage that? I mean, that was really the interest of Women's Project, was more of the, how do you do this? This has something. And that we felt, again, I'm not even going to try to say what I think Jelinek was thinking, but that we felt that the play was commenting on some way about the world we're in right now, that image is this slippery, manufactured thing. And then ultimately, I became surprised when we finally heard the play read aloud that it's actually quite moving and there's more emotional impact. And I do think a lot of that impact has to do with the way Jelinek frames women in the world. There's a section of the play in which she's talking about Marilyn and the Kennedy boys and how, you know, sort of how they broke her. And I remember a moment in the rehearsal room when Tina read that section and I went, oh my God, this is every woman anywhere who's been abused by a man. This is White House interns. This is, you know, women being sold into sexual slavery. And it was very emotional in the rehearsal room. So it's all there, but it's not actually what pulled me into the play initially.
Do you have anything you want to add?
No, I have to say that, yeah, I have to agree a little bit with Megan. What I was attracted to was the text itself and an image of Jackie. And I mean, I'm born in 1972, and I know so little about Kennedys. And when I'm from, we are overwhelmed by America image a lot. So I remember Jackie only from photos, of course, and I was attracted to that idea to learn first more about her. But also, the text itself, it's so fascinating and so challenging for director how to do this, that I was what was so important for me. And that idea of lightness and darkness, I was working on a show about lights, and that's how actually this play came about, because we're trying to have a light as a character in our show. And we started reading this play, and that's, I realized, oh my God, I want to do this play, because there's abstract element of light and lightness and darkness that she talks about, but then refer to herself as a darkness and Marilyn as a lightness, yeah. And then, yeah, of course, my friend said the other day she came to see the show, and she didn't read the play or anything. She came to see the show. She came back to me, and she said, I was thinking about Michelle Obama the whole time. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's really good.
Well, maybe this is a time to open the discussion up to the audience. Yes?
Jackie and Marilyn... How about Jackie and Maria Callas?
Yeah, there's none of that in the play.
There's not a lot about Ari.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
But Maria Callas, she'd make a play too.
Yeah.
Because then Jackie would be the other woman for those 9 years that.
She has a line in the play that she says twice, so many lovers. I guess that's part of it.
But it's Jackie as the other, and Jackie as Jackie. So it's complicated. Thank you. Just a suggestion.
That passage is, she talks about the fact that she doesn't care about Jack's innumerable lovers because none of them get it.
Yeah.
What does that mean? I know Gita doesn't want me to ask what it means, but I want to.
After we explain that one.
I don't know. It's hard to think about the text, and
but you can. I mean, what do we read from all these gossipy books that we all have fun reading? Jackie knew all about Jack's lovers, and she make herself so busy not to think about it. Renovation of the White House, buying a lot of clothes.
And she only cared when it. Sort of when the contract was breached, which was when it became public in any way, when he wasn't discreet. Yeah. So,
and with Merlin, he wasn't discreet. It was a little bit dangerous that all was going to come out, and she was really angry about that.
Yeah, so I think the they didn't get it was that they didn't understand that she was after something else. I'm not going to remember the quote, but there's an actual Jackie quote that... about the way women find power, and some of them, it's like there are some women who find their power in bed, and other women. Do you remember what it is?
There are two kinds of women.
There are two kinds of women.
They have power in the men.
One kind has power in bed, and the other kind has power in.
I don't know.
The world in the world anyway.
Yeah.
But Jackie had power in the world.
Well, actually, something close to that, she's actually withholding herself.
Mm. Right.
That's
right,
where the power
right,
is.
Right.
Yeah. That she's removing herself. Yeah. Steps outside the door.
I saw her once. She came to a play by Václav Havel, and she was sitting in the first row, and she was like some sort of study in finishing school poise. She, you know, they say that each of us touches our face 7 times a minute or whatever. She never touched her face. She never moved beyond the picture perfect pose. There was something about her that was so good at being, the center of attention that she really did attract all of this light to her. You couldn't look away from her. It was almost unfair to the actors. everyone was just looking at her. It was extraordinary. Other questions? Yes.
You talked a lot about the pool. I'm sure I'm not the only person who thought a lot about birth waters, because having to do with the miscarriages and being attracted to the ocean and going there to recuperate. And my wife had 8 pregnancies with one spectacularly young man who's 27 and is a dramaturg. And he's graduating from Brooklyn College with a master's in theater history, and he applied here. And he told me, rub the wall for good luck, because he wants to come here for his PhD. And but that is a divergence. But I thought a lot about the birth waters because of my own situation. And how we used to go to the Port Washington Pier after every problem pregnancy. And I think that the pool is symbolically and actually both the pleasure of the beach and the tranquility of the water and birth waters that produce death and produce life. And that's why I think people are always attracted to water. This is where we spend 9 months.
That's beautiful.
That is nice.
Thank you.
Like that.
Write that down.
My son said to me, Dad, and this is the reason I'm here today, Providence is working. He said, dozens of doctors and hundreds of people love your stories, and you gave me the title for your book yourself. Since I have Parkinson's, my glass has become 2/3 full. Hmm. And I've met some spectacular people. And almost every meeting I go to, Parkinson's support group meetings like Bachman Strauss today, held upstairs, people tell me that I inspire them. And I had someone who was 82 years old who sat next to me at one of the meetings at Beth Israel. And she said, as we went around, how long she had Parkinson's. My name is Betsy, and it's my privilege to sit next to such an inspiring person like Bob, and that's me. And she came up to me after the meeting and said, could I rub your arm? I said, you can do that, Betsy. You have to tell me why. She goes, because I need to get enough inspiration to get to next month's meeting. And rubbing your arm, I'll get that inspiration. And she, and so I said, go ahead. And she came in the next month with a book that she wrote about women evolving and changing careers. And she got a teacher's college at Columbia. She's an alumni of mine. And but it had so much relevance for me, is changing throughout my life as a boy from the Bronx and winding up at the insistence of the superintendent, assistant superintendent, going to Columbia University, where my son was accepted, and his professor said, don't go into debt for $250,000. They don't give any money in that department. And they offer nothing to anybody. They offer him $10,000, and $20,000, and $30,000.
So sir, are you going to wind this up in a question, I hope?
Yes.
Okay.
And the question I have is, does that resonate, the idea of birth waters, with any of you, anybody else? And my real question is that my son is holding his breath right now because he's a spectacular student. I even said to him, how come you graduated magna cum laude? You didn't get magna cum laude. He said, Dad, summa's better. And he's got 6 years of straight A's, and he's a working dramaturg at the Park Playhouse in Albany.
Okay, let's stick with the birth waters question. Does it resonate with you?
Thank you for the compliment.
It's not something that ever came up in our conversations. I mean, I mean, it's certainly there, but it's not something that we ever specifically talked about.
I mean, I think that once you have a kind of, you know, iconic, I mean, it's going to be a set of references for everyone. Yeah. So it's interesting to hear different people's relationship with it. So,
yes.
First of all, I haven't seen the play. I'm looking at it in the general aspect. I think writing about Jackie is about 50 years ahead of its time. It's like writing about Lincoln in 1900. Not enough material has come out. I'm sure there are a lot of stories to be told. I remember living through that time, and she was a goddess as far as we were concerned. The Princess of the United States. Everybody took it that way. But the point is, I think writing about it at this point is just a little too soon. About 50 years too soon. You talk about the language that's in the play. Look at a 1930s movie and look at the script and you laugh. The script seems so infantile to us. So you need a little time to step back and look at things. And you have to digest all that stuff. It just takes time. And I doubt very much that many of us are going to have enough time to see that. But the point is, I still say the main thing is, like I say, you're talking about language. There's stuff on television today, even I'm embarrassed about. And I'm no baby. So what I say here, once again, it's just too soon to write about Jackie.
Does anybody want to pick up on the too soon? Yeah.
Maybe not quite the too soon, but because I, again, yes, we take Jackie as an icon. And I think the whole idea of the icon versus the person behind the icon is of interest because especially now when people
through the internet can create avatars of themselves, so many of them, that we don't even know anymore, or people who communicate through the internet with thousands of people, they don't know with whom they are communicating, because these are personas made up. So I think from that point of view, the question of persona and multiple personas, as Jackie constructed and projected, and one was aware of that even at the time, that the idea of the kind of the elegance and the worldliness that was a new image of the young American at that time, a very brief image, I think that conscious construction that preceded already her being the president's wife, she constructed herself already earlier. I think in our own time, these multiple constructions are becoming almost pathological.
Certainly common.
Common.
Is there a princess play about Princess Di?
Yeah.
So it's not the only recently deceased historical figure.
So my question is, and I will go, I'm very curious to see the play, and I have to confess that I've read Elfriede Jelinek in German, and I've always had great problems reading her, and she really pushes you away in the process. So I'm curious to see how you, and I was very interested to hear how you grappled with that, being pushed away by her.
She pushed us away a lot. Yeah.
I wanted to know how you dealt with that. Mm. That's totally from where I began. It's totally different from where I ended up with this.
It's funny because I've read a few of her novels, and my German skills are really poor, so I've seen plays of hers in Germany, but I can't give you details about them. But the novels, I think, I find really hard to read, and they're like repulsive, and they really push you away so much inside of them. Like, the characters are like there was this one I read, Wonderful, I think it's called Wonderful, Wonderful Times, and the characters are totally repulsive, like people that you really don't want to read a novel about. And so, I mean, I found in working on this that she pushes you away, and or for me, that it's hard to kind of figure out how to get inside of it, but the subject is not as repulsive, I mean, as her other subjects can be. Like, her agent was telling me about a recent play of hers, which is about, you know, these people at this party, and they decide to go out and kill a bunch of Jews at the end of the party, and that's what the play is about. And so this play doesn't have that kind of, like, it doesn't have that degree of, like, historical repulsion that I think a lot of her other works.
But as much as she pushes you away, you can forget. And I think that's how you keep coming back. Once you read it, and this play is relatively short, once you read it, when you read, I mean, I'm so used to this text, every night I go to bed and the lines of the text is bomb, bomb, bomb. It's amazing. It has a really incredible impact on you. And yes, I watch the audience a lot, how they follow the play, so they... So they're in it, they're out, they're in, they're out. It's really interesting what it does, but it's the effect is that you really can't get out of your head after you see it.
Yeah, we all dreamed about the play every night.
Yeah. We have time for just one more question. So who wants to be the last? In the middle there, yes.
I'm afraid it's not a very deep question. It was just a technical question the evening when I went to see the play, because I've seen the play and it's brilliant, you should all go and see it.
Oh, thank you.
But there was an incident that I wasn't sure whether it was supposed to be in the play, where a woman had translation and she had the wrong thing. Was that part of
No, no, it wasn't.
I'm so glad you saw that show.
That was a great show. I don't understand what happened. Can someone explain?
We started the show and there was a lady sitting in the first row, and she had the headphones. That,
assisted listening yeah, device.
And she loudly starts saying an interrupting performance. This is not a right show. Why do I have this
it was
show?
The, it was the feed from the show next door.
Next
she was
one.
Getting the dialogue from the show so next our, door.
So our
that
poor actress, it was yeah. incredible. Yeah. It was so good. So you saw it. So.
But I thought that the actor, Tina,
she
was so beautiful.
She stayed in Jackie's character and politely talked to the lady and promised her she's going to talk louder.
She
has,
the
woman actually it was
left.
Funny.
Oh, Taya, you have to steal that. You have to use that.
And then, next, and then
she came back, and then the actress, she talked about, please take them off because of the technology, we don't need that technology. I thought, I was feeling like, was that part of the thing or not? Thank you.
We gave Tina freedom too.
Yeah, we told her.
She handled it well.
It happened again with a woman's cell phone went off. And so the woman was very polite. She immediately got up and sort of tried to get out to turn off her cell phone, but it was still disruptive. So Tina commented on that.
And she said the line, you can leave, I can't. Something like
yeah.
that. It was really, and it's sort of that accent that you were talking about, it brought everybody together. It was a really good show.
Well, that's a great ending point. So I would like to thank everyone for coming. I'd like to thank our panelists.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.